Okay, coming to you live from Chicago at KubeCon. We're in the third day. We're just about a couple hours from wrapping it all up. And I am here with Thibaut Rouffineau from Canonical. You head marketing over there, yes?
That's correct.
Oh, cool. And so let's just start talking about some of the stuff that's going on. We can start with the desktop and then go from there to some of the bigger initiatives that you're working on and focusing on. So you always do your... with your code names, it's all alphabetical. You pick an adjective, you pick an animal, and usually I will either know the adjective or I will know the animal, but I don't know them both. So you just release something Minotaur. I know what a Minotaur is. I didn't know the adjective. What is the adjective?
Mantic one.
It's what?
Mantic.
Okay, and it's not manic, it's mantic.
That's correct.
Okay, and so what is mantic?
It's about foreseeing and being...
Prescient?
More like a bit of a mentalist, I guess, is probably the best way to put it.
See, this is the things. I don't know who comes up with these, but anyway, you just get a little closer.
All right, I know exactly who does, but I won't tell you.
So, yeah, exactly. I might have an idea as well. So, and then this one, I know what the next one coming up, which is the LTS, long-term support, and that will be for 2404. And that one is noble, which I know what that word means. And it's a Nambat?
Nambat, yeah.
Okay, and what is a Nambat for our viewers at home who may not know? Because I had to look it up.
It's a small rodent from Australia.
Oh, of course, yes. That was my first guess.
Yes.
So with the new LTS, what is coming out? What have you talked about as far as new directions or what you're going to be doubling down on or...
Well, so usually the latest non-LTS release is almost kind of a foretaste of what's going to come in the LTS. So the release that came out about three weeks ago or so has got some of the elements that are really going to be important there. One of the element is the full description that is hardware-based, TPM-based. So that's going to be quite exciting for our April 2024 release, because not everyone knows that 2404 stands for April 2024.
Yeah, once you crack the code, it's, oh my gosh, that's yes. How it is. That's what those random numbers are.
Exactly, but it's worthwhile kind of reiterating. So that's what one of the interesting angle that there's also a bunch of enterprise features and better management of desktop at scale that are going to come with that. We see that as, you know, particularly important to continue the enterprise and developer penetration of Ubuntu, and I have to say, like, working with Dell on that has been an absolute great results, great volume of PCs shipping, and iconic devices that you might be aware of.
Yes, I mean it's crazy. I actually met Mark at another company, and we did little stuff together, but it's really at Dell where the partnership has gone, both on the server side as well as the client side. And of course, we always sold a boatload of Ubuntu on top of our more economic offerings, and so you could get a low price point. And there are a lot of people who wanted that with Project Sputnik, the developer edition. The big difference is put this free OS on top of our top of the line system. And of course, that was a big head scratcher for most people in Dell. Why would a developer want a really good system and then just put this free OS on it? So we're now in our 11th year this month. So we're doing something right together there. And just back to the cracking of the code. So you have releases twice a year. And so that's where the 04, which would be April. And then you have 10, which would be?
October. Sorry, I blanked out. It is Thursday, the last day of the conference.
I was going to say that was a test. You passed. And then, are you? So it's been that way forever. And are you still 6 months after the GNOME release? Is that how you're pinning your? I know, at least that's how it started out.
I can't tell you actually. This is the limit of my knowledge as a marketing person.
That's all right. We can switch other things. So desktop, obviously, where Canonical made its name, where it's still just doing gangbusters. But as far as your focus, you're going further into the enterprise with bigger types of offerings or more complex ones. What would you say? I know AI is something we wanted to talk about. Is there any other big say your, well, I guess you can talk about your Kubernetes efforts first, mm-hmm. and then we can get into AI.
Well, before I talk about just Kubernetes effort, I was saying a lot of people have asked us and continue to ask us, what are you doing at KubeCon? What do you do that's cloud native?
Everybody knows your desktop
exactly.
and says, got
the
it.
The desktop, but the server, but then they, you know, associate it with big fat server and what did it have to do with my containers?
Right.
And so there's two answers to that. The first one is, well, the server itself is what runs a lot of the Kubernetes, underlying Kubernetes, first of all. And then on the container side, we've announced last year what is called chiseled containers, which are tiny.
Is it chiseled?
Yes. Tiny containers based on Ubuntu that allow you to have almost kind of distro-less container type containers based on Ubuntu.
Is it LXE or was it LXE?
No. They're just like normal Docker containers or nowadays not Docker anymore. but yeah, so just normal containers, but much smaller, like 8 megabytes as opposed to hundreds of megabytes, depending on where you do there. So we started with .NET, and overall, increasingly, we're making that available for other platforms like Go, Python, Java. So that being one of the key areas of conversation here. I always say that each KubeCon has got a different flavor. Mm-hmm. And the big flavor I saw in this one has been very strong developer population. In the past, you had some KubeCon with just SREs and people who run infra.
The ops side, right.
Yeah, and here, there's a lot of developers. And from that standpoint, that's been quite an interesting conversation. So, yes, that's been one of the angles of the conversation here at KubeCon this year. And as you mentioned, who hasn't said AIML 20,000 times this year?
Yes, you can't swing a dead cat without hearing that. But
So that's been also one of the area of focus for us to number of reasons. First of all, you mentioned the fact that Ubuntu as a desktop environment is the number one desktop environment for anyone doing AI. This year, in a very funny way, we've seen an absolute increase of downloads in August for students going back to school because they knew that if they were going to work on any AI project, which is the cool thing to do if you're computer science, Ubuntu is the best platform to do it on.
So and I was going to say, we've actually had for years now, maybe 3 or 4 years, the precision line with Ubuntu targeted at data scientists, machine learning, AI. So it's something that we realize the value of, and like you say, Ubuntu is the OS of choice for most people.
And so that's our heritage in a sense, and we've been working with you, with NVIDIA, to make sure that we have the kind of best development environment, but also in production, mm-hmm. whether it's like, once again, Dell server with NVIDIA GPUs. And there's a project that's been around for a while, but currently recently graduated into the CNCF called Kubeflow. Mm-hmm. And we've been offering effectively an easy way to install Kubeflow, an easy way to manage Kubeflow. We're also helping people onboard with Kubeflow with some consultancy services, mm-hmm. managed services. And so that's been also a lot of interest around this at KubeCon this year.
And so what else can you talk about, say, back on the server side? Because you said your number one desktop on the back end of the servers for most clouds, it's Ubuntu for quite a few of them.
Indeed. This has been the case for a long time. It's always something that people forget about, that the majority of the kind of VMs on public clouds are going to be running on Ubuntu. So for us, it's always something that we love working on as a continuous improvement area. And from that standpoint, recently, interesting announcement we've done, interesting work has been around confidential computing. So we always want to be right at the leading edge of what's happening in
confidential computing. What might that be? Is that hardened security or?
No, so if running an Ubuntu VM in any public cloud, but making sure that the public cloud themselves have no visibility whatsoever in what you do within that VM. And so that's, we believe that in many ways that might be the future of compute, that a lot of people would say, hey, well, no one gets to know what's running in my VM. there. And so we've been leading and working with the various public clouds on that topic. So that's been, you know, as I mentioned, we've been the number one OS in all public clouds, and we're now trying to make sure that, hey, we want to continue to be at the leading edge of that.
So now Snaps is, I'm not going to say new, because now it's been around for quite a while. If you can just give a quick explanation of Snaps, and is it my understanding of, or the context is the desktop. Is that now, is it all through the server? Is that going to play a big role in AI? Where do Snaps go? Starting with what are Snaps?
So Snaps originally, what a lot of people don't know, come from the desktop project, phone project. The idea was to have, in the same way that in a phone, you have an application that doesn't have access to the underlying operating system, that doesn't have access to the other application content, that's where it comes from. So very way to isolate the applications. So that's the behavior, but also from an upgrade perspective, on a phone, you don't worry about removing an application and adding an application. It doesn't screw up anything. When on the desktop, not always the case.
Right.
So that's where Snaps came from originally. And when the phone project finished, we moved to using Snaps both on the desktop and in IoT for two different reasons. On the desktop, it was the easy use. You can install a piece of software, remove a piece of software, and you leave your machine in exactly the same state it was in. And on the IoT side, it was more around over-the-air upgrades and so on and so forth. But over time, all the applications that have been existing on Snaps, a lot of people have really enjoyed that ability to just install something, enjoy it, in not think about dependencies and so on and so forth.
Well, that's what I was going to ask about dependencies. How does that work that they...
So dependencies are all built in to into the application itself, into the Snap itself. So you have an application that comes with all its dependencies so that it doesn't, write its dependencies on disk and screw up the rest of your file system, and B, also doesn't rely on either newer, older versions that, once again, might not be there. So, so what happened, though, is that these applications that run on desktop, they also run on servers. And as we have a very strong, developer audience that I mentioned, we had a lot of things that started as Snaps on the desktop that have taken a life elsewhere. When we launched a microcage, which is our small version of Kubernetes, as a more development environment, then it started becoming available for small clusters. And nowadays it's available from anywhere from running on a single node IoT device all the way to building Kubernetes clusters in production.
So if we get back to AI, we talked about it. Is there anything you can talk about that's not top secret of a direction you're heading or what you might be doing? And then we'll pivot to Edge. I'm just hearing what you're doing there.
Yeah. So as I mentioned, Kubeflow is really the big thing. I think what we'll see next year around AI is more collaboration. I think to make sure that the AI developer to production experience is smooth from software stack, the hardware stack, and that anyone can just jump in and get started.
Yeah, and simple is hard, right? And that's what you want to do. You want to make it user friendly. You want to abstract things so people don't have to think about it, and it just works. To end with Edge, where are you all with that, and where does that play into your overall strategy?
We've been offering. First of all, Edge needs to be defined by the person who answers the question.
Right,
probably the first thing I was going to do. The two things there, we've been working with Dell actually on Edge as more kind of Edge cluster. I'm going to differentiate Edge cluster from just IoT gateways type thing, but more on the Edge cluster side. We've been working with Dell on the latest, and this is where you might want to help me.
This is on the other side of the house, so I'm going to, I forget that, and you're going to mention something that I've heard, and then I'm going to...
So we've been working on that, and next week we're going to be announcing, and actually some people from Dell are going to be there. We're launching a product called MicroCloud, which is the ability to build edge cloud with the power of Snap that I just mentioned, which is, you know, one single line of code, on the CLI, and then you got a cloud up and running, clustered, no need to kind of have, you know, a PhD or lines and lines of code to set that up. So yes, that's coming next week. Slightly confidential until next week, so that's okay.
So I'll hold that. Very interesting. What is old is new. Did Mark say microcloud, Mark Shuttleworth?
We've been calling some of our product micro for a while. So we've had microcage, we have microstack, and microcloud is kind of a generic name we were giving to. We were trying to explain a bit better edge, because under the term edge, some people talked about one single node, some people talk about 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 nodes.
Right.
We started saying, okay, well, the moment things are clustered, we can't, give that a name. Let's call that microcloud as opposed to a single node, which would be more, in our view, an IoT type device. So knowing that definition, we used to call that microcloud, and we tried to kind of like push that as a concept, and now we're coming up with a product that's named that way, so it's quite exciting.
So what the reason why I bring it up is when originally went to Mark and said, hey, we really want to do this developer edition with Ubuntu. We want to work together on it. He said, that's interesting, but what we really want to do is we want to make it so you can build a micro cloud on your desktop, and then you can use LXC to push it up to the cloud. And so that was the vision. Turned out to be harder than we had thought, but luckily this company, Docker, came along and did what we needed to do, and it ended up being a great thing to use the developer edition. So that's what I was wondering out if he sort of pulled it out, dusted it off, and said now we can use it again. So anything else just that you'd like to mention to our listeners or viewers out there?
We've been partly lately working quite a bit on the desktop together, and what we're finding is the more feedback you have, the more kind of interesting use cases, just share that with us. I feel like we're sometimes not hearing enough cool stories about what you're doing with Dell hardware and Ubuntu software. So if you have good stories out there, just reach out to us.
Yeah, and I think that's true, both the good and the bad. I think I was just telling some people is the feedback from the community often alerts you to things that, you know, things will happen, like all of a sudden in Denmark one time, it just wasn't where it was supposed to be on the website. We launched it, somebody complained about it or called it to our attention, and that was great, because then it was a screw up and we went to the mm-hmm. to the web team, and then boom, better that than no one in Denmark telling us that, then nobody buys it in Denmark. So I think, yeah, the power of the community, good and bad, is something very helpful. So Thibaut Rouffineau, did I say that correctly?
That was beautiful.
Stop it some more. So that is it. We're wrapping up KubeCon here from Chicago. And so to all our listeners out there, remember to keep your feet on the ground and keep reaching for the stars. Take care and good night.